What is the subject this morning? Who is responsible for our sufferings? Do you think that you really suffer? How do you suffer? Physically or mentally? Actually, physical body cannot experience any kind of suffering. Yes, pain is experienced by the mind. If there is no mind, no feeling. So body is just like a piece of wood. Mind experience pain and pleasure both. But the body is the channel. So certain areas in the body here and there, when something goes wrong, out of order, then the mind gets the message. Who experienced the pain? The mind. Body cannot experience. But we a spot, this is the place. But the mind is there. Do you know where the mind is? Where is our mind? There is a wrong concept or belief started long ago, few thousand years ago, that mind is located in our heart. This is very old, out-of-date philosophy, psychology. The mind is in our heart. That is why we started to say kind-hearted. They think the kindness in our heart. It is wrong. No, take out and see how you feel. And then you can understand. So, this belief they maintain for a few thousand years, the mind is in our heart. Later, when medical science started to develop, they thought, according to their experiment, that mind is not in our heart, but in our brain. Because they can see so many things are functioning there, very active in our brain. So the mind is in the brain. So according to ancient medical theory. Later, modern psychologists and many others found out that mind is not located in any particular area in our body, neither in our heart nor in our brain, but mind is an energy, just like electricity. Electricity is not located any particular area. It is an energy, it is a current. So the mind is an energy. And this energy is functioning all over the body. This is the latest discovery. That is how the mind can experience any kind of feeling. How many kinds of feelings are there? How many things do we experience? Three, isn't it? What are those three? Pleasant, unpleasant, neutral. Three. Actually, more neutral feeling. But neutral feeling we don't take seriously. Just ignore. We take only pleasant and unpleasant. When there is no pleasant feeling, then neutral feeling is there. When there is no unpleasant feeling, a neutral feeling is there. Then, this feeling we experience in three ways. Now, what is the Buddha's advice about this heart, where it is? There is a saying the Buddha saying in Dhammapada. You have read that book, isn't it? Note it. Where the heart is, the mind is, in Dhammapada you can find. The saying is like this. Durang gamang eka charang asarirang guhasayang ye chittang sanyamissanti mukhanti marabandana. That is what the Buddha says. The nature of the mind, he says, durangama can travel very far and very fast. There is no any other kind of energy in this universe which can run so fast than the mind. Even the lightning is not very fast. Mind can run few thousands times higher than the lightning. This is the nature of mental energy. So, durangamang ekacharang. Ekacharang, live alone. No companion for our mind. Heart got companion, isn't it? Sweet heart, bitter heart, companion. But mind has no companion. That means, now this is a very interesting thing. Two persons in this world cannot agree each other. Never. You cannot find two human beings in this world who can agree equally. Always there are differences. Husband and wife, parents and children, who are so close to each other, even then, how many differences are there? Now, this is the nature of the mind. I have my own mind, my own way of thinking, my own character. But your way of thinking, your character is entirely different. Although we work together. So, our conflict, clashes, misunderstanding, enmity, all these problems take place because of this. One cannot agree with the other. So what we have to do, we have to train our mind to cooperate. Otherwise we cannot make one mind. Both cannot bring into the same line. We must know how to cooperate with the other person, although there are differences. Now it is like this. Assume, husband is very hot-tempered. Now that is his character. One word is enough to make him angry and flare up his anger, he shout and jump and make havoc there. That is his character. If wife tries to change his mind, she experienced it is impossible. She cannot change husband's way of mind, character. So what she has to do, by knowing that my husband is like this, if I want to live with him, if I want to regard him as my husband, so my duty is to associate with him by knowing he is a hot-tempered man. That means not to aggravate him, not to irritate him, not to provoke him, then she can handle him. Again, wife is a very jealous type of lady. I do not know, some people say ladies are jealous. I don't know how far it is true. People say, don't blame me. People say. wife is very jealous. Husband cannot change her mind. If this husband wants to live with her, he must know how to behave in such a way not to create too much suspicion in her mind. Naturally, they create suspicion. When he comes home very late, suspicion create in the mind. Therefore, his duty is to come home earlier. There are many things that he has to adjust to avoid suspicion. Then she reduced her jealousy. Again, when the husband wants to talk to another young lady, he got to be very careful. She should not do that in front of her wife. The wife cannot tolerate it. Create jealousy. But he must know how to behave. This is the way how they have to cooperate. So there are no two persons, ekatta kaya nanatta sanya. Nanatta kaya ekatta sanya. This is another nice saying of the Buddha. How our equality and differences, physically united, mentally divided. Physically united means our elements, energies, the formations of physical body, functioning, all these glands and organs and sicknesses may be very common. But way of thinking, mentality, temperament are entirely different. Again, ekatta sanya nanatta kaya. By using our full effort, we try to cooperate with the other person, to harmonize. Now we try to maintain harmony and understanding, to work together. Then the trouble started there. Physically we are again divided. My physical body and the other person's physical bodies are entirely different. When the mind tries to cooperate, physical body differ. When physical body tries to cooperate, the mind differ. These are the differences that we are experiencing every day. Still I did not explain what the Buddha says about the mind. Just now I told you, mind can run very fast. Mind runs alone. No companion for our mind. That's why when you meditate, only one mind. You cannot have two minds there. Two minds together cannot meditate individually. Then, durangamang ekajana asariran. No body. No body means no formation. Visible, tangible object in the mind. That is what all the other religions also say about the soul. The soul has no formations, and in simple language they are also trying to say soul is an energy, invisible, without any formation. So there is nothing here in our physical body to point out. The mind is like this. Having seen, observing, studying person's way of doing things, then we say, oh, his mind is like this. But we cannot see the mind. Asariran, no formation. Guha sayang. Now this is the misleading word, the Buddha word. Live in a cave, like batu caves. This is a very misleading word. The mind live in a cave inside our body. That is why the ancient philosophers thought it must be in our heart. It's a very nice cave. The mind is hiding inside the heart. Then the scientists and doctors, medical science, say mind is hiding in the brain. So when you analyze these sayings of the Buddha here, what he says, is not in a particular area, any locality, but mix up with the blood. Mind is functioning with our blood. Blood runs through the tube, blood vessels. This is the cave. This mental energy also runs as an energy with the blood. This is the way how we can merge, cooperate with the modern scientific discoveries. Then let us come back to suffering. Who experience suffering? Mind. When doctors want to operate us, they give anesthetic injection. After that they can do anything, we don't feel. No feeling. Because the brain cells and so many things inside our body which contribute to experience something, pain and pleasure in our mind, is already numb and no feeling at that time for a few hours. After a few hours, again get back. So mind can experience. And those who said mind is in our heart is wrong. Heart transplantation, operation. So when my heart is weak, they remove my heart and take another person's heart and transplant here. If the mind is in the heart, I get another person's mind after this operation. It clearly shows that ancient belief is wrong. Then the question is, who is responsible? Why do we want to suffer? It is not that we want to suffer. Why do we suffer? Last Sunday also, I mentioned the others say that we are suffering here in this world. At the beginning, we have committed sins, and that is called original sin. Because of this original sin, we had to suffer from sicknesses, old age, death, and so many problems. Therefore, we must be baptized according to their religion. After that, the God can take away the sins. Then only we can go to heaven. Another interpretation. Sufferings, sicknesses, problems also created by the God for us to experience pain. Purposely He has created to test whether we can tolerate or not. So your duty is to tolerate your suffering, thinking that God is testing. You are in the God's test tube. He is doing some experiment. Whether you are entitled, suitable to go to heaven. If you create further problems and troubles, commit more violence, because of your suffering, then you have no chance to go to heaven. So your duty is to say like this, what to do. He knows why I suffer. It is will of God, act of God, His wish. What can I do? I must be prepared to go to heaven. Now this is their religion. Now this is the way how they try to console by giving some ideas for you to hold on. to keep quiet without creating further problem. Now our argument is this. Assume that it is true that he want to test whether we are suitable to go to heaven. If his idea is to send us to heaven, if the purpose of creation is to send us to heaven or to enjoy heavenly bliss, then what is the big idea of creating us here in this world to suffer? And what is the difficulty that he has to come across of creating us at once in heaven? Why can't he create us in heaven at once without allowing us to suffer like this? Why? Where is the answer? Why is it necessary for him to test? For what purpose? If he want to test me, he is not sure. He is the creator. To us, actually, this is a cock and bull story. No meaning at all. And then what is the Buddhist point of view? Attainment of Buddhahood or gaining enlightenment, still many people have not realized what it is. Although we worship and do some offerings, still we have not realized what is this enlightenment, what he realized. That's why some people say, oh, he was inspired by God, or given a message, then he, through this divinity, he gained enlightenment. Otherwise, how can an ordinary human mind gain enlightenment? These are the things people cannot understand. Because all the others got some sort of message from heaven, from God. There is something which we cannot understand. Message was given to whole mankind. But he has given this message very secretly, hiding somewhere, only to one man. Why it is like this? Why can't he appear and announce, this is for the whole mankind? There won't be any controversy. Everybody accept. One man come down from a hill, tell us, you know, when I was there, God appeared. And he gave me this message. He asked me to convey this message to others. Why it is necessary? To see only one man. Now that we cannot understand. Some sort of secret. So this is not a secret message. This message is for the whole mankind, for all of us to uphold, to practice. What is the difficulty for him to appear and announce? Everybody accept. He cannot do that. That is why we cannot accept this. We never accept this. Then, the Buddha. When you study the background, the effort, the knowledge, sacrifices, development that he has done, life after life, such a long period, went on developing, cultivating, realizing, then eradicating, reducing all the weaknesses and immoral and bad habits, weaknesses. So step by step he went on developing until he reached the final goal. There is no divine message behind. His own effort. And you also can gain the same thing if you work for that. Then he studied all the existing religions, philosophy, psychology, science and everything at that time in India. As a young prince, while enjoying his worldly life, all the while he was contemplating very deeply, not like us. While enjoying, he was contemplating, thinking, analyzing, why it is like this, why it is like this. This is called realization. I think you can remember a minor incident which has become the turning point for him to determine to renounce worldly life. Very minor incident. But he took it very seriously. What is that? As a young prince, when he was sitting in his garden, one day he has seen suddenly a snake appear and caught a frog or lizard. He was watching. Then this frog or lizard was struggling, fighting to escape. And this snake is using full force to swallow. When this battle was going on between the snake and the frog, another big bird came down and taken away the snake. And the frog is still in the mouth. This is a very minor incident. But he took this very seriously. He thought, contemplated very deeply. Oh, this is the nature of existence. Every living being in this world, on this earth, in the water, big or small, a struggle for survival, for living. It is a big battle. The whole world is nothing but a battlefield for all these existing living beings to catch each other. And each and every living being is trying to escape, and others trying to catch. That is what all these living beings are doing all over the world. See the way how we analyze. Big one try to catch the other one, and that one try to catch another one, that one try to catch another one, and goes, this battle goes up to the end of the tiniest creature. One swallows the other. This is the nature. But can we say this nature is justifiable, peaceful, acceptable, meaningful, just because it is the nature? The nature is not in our favor. Remember this. People always say, oh, it is the nature, it is natural. Nature is not in our favor. Although they are natural occurrences. So this battle is natural. But we try to escape. How long can we escape? And then he thought, there is no meaning at all. Fighting, struggling for our survival. In this existence, there is no meaning. The more we live, the more we had to grumble, accuse, criticize, condemn, blame and curse and suffer. Every day, every hour, every minute, we are complaining. We talk only about our problems. From our birth up to the last breath, if we can analyze what sort of problems and troubles and sufferings and difficulties, unhappiness that we had to experience through our life, crying and weeping and accusing and fighting and quarreling. Why? In the end, what do we gain? Where is happiness? What is the meaning of this existence? Is there anybody else who is ready to take the responsibility of our suffering? All right? When we have some problems or troubles, just to satisfy ourselves, we go and express our grievances, saying, I want to go and pray. Pray means I want to go and report to God who created us. Why you created us like this, to suffer? In Ethiopia, how many millions of human beings have been dying and dying without food? Who created them? One who created them is hiding. Is it not his duty to provide food for them who created them? If he can't afford to feed them, why did he want to create such an unfortunate human being to suffer? But they also pray. Every day they pray, asking their protection, precaution, blessings and this and that, everything. So here you can understand, we cannot settle our problem simply by praying to somebody else or asking favor. That is what the Buddha said. I must try to find out where the secret. No one has realized why we suffer. We create our own imagination, accuse others for nothing, create more enmity, more unhappiness. Then he realized, by enjoying my life as a royal prince in a palace, I won't be able to find out the secret. Now that is why he decided to renounce, keep away from bondages, keep away from attachment, must have free mind. That is called renunciation. Now then went on, this is the continuation, because he had been doing this life after life, he wanted to complete the remaining few points. He worked for 6 years. He got it. That is called enlightenment. Buddhahood. Supreme enlightenment. Samma Sambuddha. Not ordinary Buddha. It's called Samma Sambuddha. Supreme enlightened Buddha. And what did he realize? When you compare all these existing religions, Hinduism, Jainism, Buddhism, Christianity, Islam, and so many other isms, there are a lot of similarities In fact, there are more similarities. That is why many people say all these religions are the same. But we use the names of different God. We practice different method according to our traditions and culture. But religions are the same. We cannot agree fully. Although there are a lot of similarities, morals and ethics in every religion, we can see the same. Every religion tell us not to kill, not to steal, not to do this, not to do this. It's okay. Every religion say not to do bad thing. Good. Every religion say do good thing. Support your father and mother and wife and children and do your duty. Yes. Every religion tell us maintain some sort of discipline, behave as cultured people. Good. These are the similarities. Then, when we come to this particular point, why we suffer? Why we cannot satisfy with our life? Although we have more than enough things, we differ. We give different interpretation. Explanation. Then many of those existing religions say the Creator, the God who created us, is responsible for everything. We are more or less puppets. We have to dance according to His tune. You cannot dance according to your own tune. That is what they say. Your duty is to obey, pray, and believe your Creator. He will settle your problem. But not while you are living. After your death. All their promises, remember, all their promises are after your death, not while you are living here. Because they know very well you never, after your death, you never come back and complain. You miss that. Because you cannot find out who promised to send you to heaven at that time. They are very clever. All their promises after your death. Don't worry, after your death. You will be in heaven. Nobody knows what will happen to you. Here the Buddhas. Now let us take the Buddha's attitude. A man who wanted to enjoy heavenly bliss, very rich man, one day came and told him, I have no time to meditate and observe 8 precepts and this and that. I like to enjoy my worldly life. Even then, after my death, I would like to go to heaven and enjoy. And asked the Buddha to tell him how to go to heaven after his death. Then the Buddha said, why do you want to wait until you die to enjoy heavenly bliss? If you know how to handle this human life, you can experience heavenly bliss while you are living here in this world. Not only after your death. This is the Buddha's attitude. Remember this. So what did he realize? Through his enlightenment, he found out the secret. All the other existing religions have given If I say wrong interpretation, I think it's not nice. It's not the correct interpretation. That way better, I think. Not nice to say wrong, but not the correct interpretation. After gaining the enlightenment, the bliss, the happiness he gained, he expressed. Automatically these words came out from his mouth. There was nobody to listen. Just like singing. You know, when you are happy, sometimes even without your knowledge, you go on singing. Isn't it? Exactly like this. But in his case, it's not singing. A realization. So many secrets that others could not understand. He started reciting like this. Aneka jati saṃsāraṁ sandhā vissaṁ anibbisaṁ gahakāra kaṁ gave santo dukkha jati punappunaṁ gahakārak ditto si punagehaṁ nakāsi sabbate pasuka bhagga gahakutang visankhitang visankhargatang cittang tanhanang khaya majjaga. This is his way of singing under the Bodhi tree. This is the language, the spoken language too. Aneka jati sansara. Such a long period within this cycle of birth and death, repeated birth and death, I had to suffer in various ways. A struggling for my survival. Again sicknesses, old age, death and suffering. Again rebirth, old age, sicknesses, death. Again birth, old age, sicknesses, death. Again birth, sicknesses, death. That is what we are doing. We are going round and round and again start new one. In the end, again, reluctant we depart from this world, again appear, again goes one round, again appear. And sometimes two-legged, sometimes four-legged, sometimes two-winged, sometimes like snake, sometimes bird, sometimes devas, sometimes devils and ghosts and spirit and humans, changing. That is what we are doing. Here, I had this experience. Because he got that knowledge. Gahakārakaṁ gave santo. We have been searching the remedy, solution, to see the end of all our suffering, to find out who create all these problems, who create this unhappiness, who create this formation like this for us to suffer. Then he says, Gahakāraka ditto si, today I have seen who is responsible, who creates all these problems, who creates this physical body for us to suffer like this. Not in the image of God, but this is, he is going to explain, who created. Gahakāraka ditto si. Punagehaṁ nakāhasi. Now I have broken all his materials that he used to erect, to build this house once again. Dismantle and destroy. There are five. When a contractor want to build a house, he use sand, cement, stones, timber, iron. Isn't it? So in the same manner, to build this house once again, we use 5 elements or ingredients. This people could not understand, because all the while they were referring to God, but never analyze in this way to find out who is responsible. There are 5. Remember: avidya, trishna, karma, upadana, bhava. These 5 ingredients used by one particular person, that I'll tell later who this person is, used by one particular person to build this house. Last Sunday I told you, this body is not our life, isn't it? You can remember, this is a house. This is a house that the Creator, I am not referring to God, the Creator erected for that life to settle down. So life is here inside. So we are going on building again and again and again, new houses for our life. Stay there for a certain period. When this one decay, collapse, then again build another one. Now this one is going on decaying. After a few years time, then build another one. Enter into that one, then go on building. When that one decay, run away and build another one. Here these are the 5. Avidya, trishna, karma, upadana, bhava. Remember the meaning. First thing is our ignorance. First ingredient. If there is no ignorance in our mind, we never maintain wrong belief, wrong ideas, wrong words, wrong action. Because of our ignorance, we commit. When you commit more and more wrong ideas, thoughts, words and action, then we accumulate so many ingredients there. We are accumulating these to build another house. Then trishna, our craving. 3 kind of craving. You have 3 kind of craving. Kama tanha, bhava tanha, vibhava tanha. Tanha, craving. We crave to enjoy our senses. Another big battle even amongst animals because of this pleasure. To enjoy our life, we fight, we quarrel, we commit lot of bad things, immoral, wicked, cruel things to enjoy. Craving. One kind of craving. Another kind of craving, for our survival, for our living, we are doing a lot of bad things. Bluffing, swindling, cheating, robbing, killing, destroying, burning, bloodshed, violence, for our living. That craving. Not only that, we are also doing certain things for us to live, to have immortal life, everlasting life, eternal life, not knowing the nature of life. If we can understand the nature of life, we never create such ideas in our mind that there will be eternal life anywhere. It is ignorance. Second kind of craving. Third one is more dangerous. craving for non-existence. We crave not to exist. When we got fed up, when we cannot tolerate any more, we decide to commit suicide. Craving. It is craving for non-existence. Because we think when we kill ourselves, we will be able to get rid of our problem. That is ignorance. That is called unsatisfied craving. When we could not gain what we want, we cannot tolerate it. Another kind of craving for non-existence. You maintain some sort of belief in your mind that hereafter, after your death, there is nothing. All those religions, philosophy, what they talk about, our next existence or heaven or hell or another rebirth, all rubbish. No meaning at all. They say, we don't like to have another life. We don't believe that there will be another life. That means they don't like to have another life. That is also craving for non-existence. Because they don't like to be born again due to certain disappointment. Disappointment have taken place because of craving. Craving is there. These are the three kinds of craving. Craving for pleasure, craving for survival or eternal life, craving for non-existence. This craving is another strong ingredient which built this house again, used as an ingredient. Next one, karma. Every minute, day and night, even in our dreams, while we are sleeping, we accumulate certain karmas, good and bad, every minute. Minds create good and bad karmas according to our thoughts. The words that we use create good and bad karmas. The action, certain things that we do for various purposes, these three things create good karma and bad karma. Whether you believe it or not, this is natural. So this karma that we are accumulating, collecting day and night become another energetic force there. Fourth one, the attachment, our affection, our inclination that we develop towards certain things become another strong force. One of the ingredients. So, I don't want to say whether it is good or bad. This is the nature of attachment. Last one is called bhava. Bhava means karma formation. Difficult to understand. Karma formation means when we are going to die, listen carefully. One day, when we are going to die, certain strong karmas determine to condition, to produce one particular life hereafter. either to become a human being, so animals, or spirits, or deva, or brahma, so any other form of living being, due to certain particular karma. Although there are so many other karmas, good and bad. When this particular karma is settled down and working at the last thought in that dying man's mind, after that, this mental energy, pure mental energy, supports these five ingredients. Depart from here with the mental energy, then settle down again according to our own karma, either upward or downward or thisward. Karma is responsible for that, not the God. Karma is responsible. Settle down, then start to build another house. That is what the Buddha was contemplating under the Bodhi tree. He says, today I found out the Creator. Aneka jati sansaraṁ sandhāvissaṁ anibbisaṁ gahakārakaṁ gave santo dukkha jati punappa gahakārak dittosi punagehaṁ nakāsi. Now you cannot build any more house for me, because I have dismantle and destroy all these five ingredients. No more. These five ingredients are no more with him. Visankhara gatam chittam. This is a beautiful word. We can talk few hours by using this word. In my mind, no more sanskaras now. But all of us have sankaras. What does it mean? Good habits and bad habits. Mental tendencies. The nature or the way of thinking, the way of talking, the way of doing things. Our mood, attitude, character, temperament. There are 52 altogether. Our mental habit, 52. Those ingredients are no more in my mind. Sankhara gatam chittam, this chitta, this mind is pure, cleans. Those 52 ingredients are no more in my mind. Now you can understand how he gained enlightenment. Because all those rubbish are no more in the mind. We cannot get enlightenment because this is a dustbin. Lot of rubbish we accumulate. Not wisdom, knowledge, understanding. We collect rubbish. Then we have got enlightenment. Tanhanam khaya majjaka. Here the culprit. This is the Creator. In the end he says, Tanhanam khaya majjaka. Trishna. Craving, desire, anxiety, selfishness, all these words, you can merge into one. This craving is the Creator. This craving used those ingredients to build this house again and again and again. This craving developed our mind to have sensual pleasures. Struggle for survival, struggle for non-existence, craving. So this craving is completely eradicated, wipe out, no more in my mind. Then gain the enlightenment. This is the cause of suffering. Now who is responsible for your suffering? Your own craving. Remember, but you cannot accept, you cannot understand. Still you think somebody else is responsible, either God or devil. Let us analyze a little bit further. you worry about your life, it is suffering. Then who is responsible for this suffering? Your craving, isn't it? You are craving for this. You worry about your property, thinking thieves may come and take away. Then your craving towards your property is the cause of your suffering. And others come and torture you, cut you, shoot you, kill you to take away your property. Who is responsible for this suffering? Your craving. Because you have accumulated a lot of properties. If you have not done that, nobody come and disturb you. So your craving is responsible for that suffering. Again, you worry about your children, your husband, your wife. Why? You have a craving and attachment toward them. If you have no craving, attachment and love, in simple language, toward them, you never suffer. So it does not mean that you should not love your husband, your wife and your children. As I mentioned earlier, these things are natural. All these things are natural for worldly life. But on the other hand, you must remember, all these natural things in return create sufferings. Now you love your child so much. You have developed your craving and love. Give some sort of happiness. Suddenly something has happened to this child, the motor car accident, died. You suffer. Who is responsible for your suffering? Your own craving, love, attachment toward this child is the cause. Nothing else. Now that is what the Buddha wanted to tell us. It is true. Although we cannot practice, it takes long time for us to develop one after the other until we gain clear understanding. Then we have fear. Fear of sicknesses, fear of old age, fear of death. Why do we maintain this fear? Because of our craving. If there is no craving, why do we worry about them? Because these are natural. Again, we have fear. After our death, we do not know what will happen to us. You may think sometimes become an animal, or may go to hell, or become a ghost. We have that fear. Again, this fear we maintain because of our craving. Because we don't like to suffer there. So everywhere, craving, 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 nothing but craving. Craving is the main cause of suffering. When we renounce many things, then we can go on reducing, 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 reducing our suffering. Because we reduce our responsibilities, we reduce our attachment, we reduce our crazy attitude towards so many things, then the mind becomes free and reducing burden. So only method that we can adopt in order to avoid our suffering is by reducing our craving, by accumulating more and more to get rid of your suffering. In the end you experience more suffering. So that is not the solution. This is the secret of suffering. Now you can understand who creates our suffering. If I suffer, my own craving is responsible. Although others try to come and disturb me, I never suffer if I have no craving towards this physical body, this life. When a person attains arahanta, sainthood, the Buddhahood, after eradicating this craving, they do not develop any more attachment or craving toward this physical body. In fact, they are waiting to get rid of these burdens. This is a burden, this nuisance. Because every day they had to feed, clean, wash, suffer from various sicknesses. To them, it's a real burden and nuisance. Just because they don't like to commit suicide, they keep quiet. When the death comes to them, naturally, they never try to escape. They never run away. They feel happy. After that, they can experience real nibbanic bliss. At that time, they experience nibbanic bliss while suffering with the physical body. So when they are free from their physical body, they experience full bliss as nibbanic bliss. That is called experiencing nibbanic bliss, parinibbana. Nibbana and parinibbana. When a person attains arahantahood or buddhahood, it is parinibbana. But physical body still creates trouble, problems, sicknesses, old age, pain. When that physical body is no more, then parinibbana, complete freedom without any disturbances from this physical body, no more suffering.